Coming up on this episode of Never Late African Time.
If we had a magic wand here, and you could create any role for yourself, what would that role be?
Madam President.
Yes. I'm not going to take away the fact that I'm a beautiful woman, and I'm not going to dumb myself down because you think it should work. It will not work against me.
Lead women can also be scientists.
Yeah. Yeah.
The story can be around, I'm a romantic interest, but I'm also an engineer.
I was rejected 2 weeks ago before I came here. For
a role.
I really, really wanted that role.
Gosh.
But you know what? It was on a different network, so I'm glad I'm here. I'm on Netflix.
And welcome to the Never Late African Time podcast. My name is Andy Makondwana, and alongside me, my host, Zweli Mbele. How are you doing over there? Listen, together we're going to uncover the richness of Africa's entertainment industry. And today's episode is quite a controversial one because we're going to break down the debate of what we're calling the typecast effects. Yeah. So we will discuss the types of roles that women in the film industry get and whether once they get these roles and they set in, are they less likely to be able to explore a wider variety of roles outside of that.
That's right. Now, our guests today are three actresses from across the African continent, and we want to understand their experience in the entertainment industry regarding the flexibility afforded to them and the roles that they get. Now, first up, from Kenya, we have got the award-winning actress, Catherine Kamau, also known as Kate Actress.
Yes, girl.
She is best known for playing the lead Selena in the smash hit Mother-in-Law. She has now gone on to produce and star in Suna Johnny, where she earned a Best Lead Actress in a TV series at the Kenya Film Commission Kalasha Awards. On Netflix, you can catch her on Disconnect as well as Brother Jeku.
From Nigeria's Benue State, we have the lovely Sharon Ooja. I mean, we first saw her in Skinny Girl in Transit, where she played Shalewa back in 2016, right?
Yeah.
Sharon has gone on to appear in a number of films and television shows, including King of Boys.
Yeah.
Come on. From Lagos with Love, Still Failing, Lara and the Beach, and Who's the Boss? Now, one of her best exciting roles is really in the film Olotore, where she gives a moving performance of a girl going undercover to investigate human trafficking in the West Africa.
And last but most definitely not least, from Johannesburg, South Africa, we have got Candice Modiselle, a rising star, but hey, doesn't stop there. She is a dancer and actress, presenter, as well as an entrepreneur. Now, she debuted on television as a host on South Africa's most popular youth show, Yo TV. She then showed up with her acting chops when she played Lerato on South Africa's longest running telenovela, and also appears on Jaiva as the sexy sleigh queen, Vuyiswa, a certified member of the Trolleys.
Sleigh queen?
Ladies, welcome. I must say that they say it's a bad thing to be the thorn, but in this company, we're happy.
Absolutely.
We're picking up your average. Okay, all right. So ladies, I mean, if we had a magic wand here and you could create any role for yourself, what would that role be? I'll start with you, Sharon.
Madam President.
So you went straight to the top?
Mm-hmm.
Tick, tick. You want that stressful?
Yes, I'm ready.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
And you?
Look, I'm so deeply in love with the world of directing that I'd probably have a magic wand and create a director out of myself opposed to a character. So, taking that stance for
me. So you just like bossing people around?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm the last born of my sisters, so certainly.
Makes sense. Makes sense.
I would definitely be a musician.
Really?
I would want to train my voice.
Wow.
You know,
that's amazing.
Yes, exert myself, learn how to dance for months, get into character, do all the ad-libs like what Kate was doing the other day. So yeah, I want to put like so much effort because I feel like music is another way of expressing yourself as an artist. So I really want to tap into that.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, you got the looks as well to go all the way full glam into the role.
Purr.
You know what I'm trying?
The sparkles,
I like
the sparkles are here as well.
She's already dream girling here. Yeah, I like it. I like it.
Now, Candice, let's chat a little bit about perseverance. You got rejected for 5 years, and that can be demoralizing, really.
Yeah.
Why did you not just give up and think, let me try something else?
Look, I think sometimes we like to mask it, and we promote this idea that rejection is redirection, but my life is a full manifestation of that. And I think every single part of my journey has been purely intentional. I went into the industry wanting to foreground hard work, diligence, and an exceptional excellence to the craft. And that's why, for that reason, because I knew I was called for something bigger than just the glitz and the glam of entertainment, but really about creating diligence within the craft,
yeah.
I knew that everything that it came with was worth the journey.
Sure.
And it's all these stories and it's all these narratives and it's the fullness of the experience that has unearthed the potential that I am today and the potential that I continuously bring. Yeah. If you think of how a diamond is created, it's under immense pressure. And tremendous
Come
pressure.
On. True.
And without the process and undergoing trusting process and just holding on to my faith, I think if anything, my greatest tool and instrument as a storyteller is my faith.
Sure.
And then the heart that is attached to that faith and immersing and submitting myself to the craft and the faith and the passion and the love. And that entire cocktail brings me to moments like these.
Come
and
on.
I can certainly say it's always been worth it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's certainly worth it.
Yeah. Yeah. And you come from a family of entertainers. Your sisters are in the industry.
Yeah.
Why did they allow you to struggle? Did that not help you?
No, look. Remember, like I said, foregrounding the work has always been the most important. Mm. So I never wanted to look back on my journey as a storyteller and feel as though there wasn't a sense of credibility. And I never was the kind of person to take handouts or really leverage off of my sister's journeys. And they've done an exceptional job in cementing themselves in their respective spaces, both Buntle and Refile. And for me, because again, at the tender age of 10, I was already in love with storytelling. So they've really held my hand throughout their journey. And it's been less about ushering me into a space and making it easy for me, but also allowing me to make my mistakes, fall forward, fail forward, and learn from each experience.
Yeah. That's insane.
I love that.
You know what I love about you, Kate, is that you're quite daring in your career.
I
mean, from the first time you got your role in Mother-in-Law, you quit university, you were like, done, goal achieved, we're done here. First of all, how much was that check, girl? Because to quit university.
It was so little.
Really?
Yeah, looking
and
back.
You still quit.
Then, but guess what? I was like the first person to get such amount of money as an extra because it was such a tiny role.
Wait, you quit as an extra?
No, I quit school after getting the role.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
As long as you could be an extra, I was like, man, for us, cheapest.
No, but it was definitely the role that paved the way.
Yeah.
To the Selena, because I started as an extra and then I became the lead.
That's a few
months in. Yeah.
Started from the bottom.
No.
Oh, I love that.
Now, Sharon, I'm going to put you on the spot just a little bit. Yeah, when we're hearing things, there's a little birdie that has said that there's a scene where your character was supposed to sleep. And our girl over here actually fell asleep. You fell asleep and you were snoring.
Honey, I was tired. You know how you've been filming all day?
Yeah.
And they're just like, oh yeah, this scene, you're supposed to sleep. Boy, I went in. Director was like, cut, and I was snoring.
Oh my gosh.
So I was like, ooh. They had to tap me like, Sharon, they've caught. Like, oh. I was, you know, I'm acting. I was in character. But obviously, I was not in character. I was just tired.
That is funny.
Yeah.
You were like, I was method acting.
Yeah, I was method acting.
I went into the role. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I love that. Candice, I mean, with Jaiva, you got to play your first adult role, right?
Sure
was that
did.
Freeing or was it a risky move for you? Did you feel like, what am I doing?
It was so intentional. Look, if anyone's followed my career, they know that I've been infamously known to play youthful characters.
Yeah.
And the reason is because I didn't want to be sexualized prematurely.
Gotcha.
I'm aware of what I look like, but I also know that I'm exceptional at what I do.
Gotcha.
So I wanted, again, like I mentioned, foregrounding the skill set was also important for me. So once I finally stepped into Jaiva, I was able to go, girl, you can be a bad. It's okay. It's all right. Because you know what? I have a plethora of work that can speak for the skill.
Got you.
And it's not about, okay, here's a pretty girl stepping into a role as a pretty woman and not offering anything else thereafter.
Got you.
And Jaiva allowed me to do that
and to play
around with Vuyiswa, which was such an amazing experience, especially on a global platform like Netflix.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Sheesh.
Yeah. Now, that's Kate, you were on Mother-in-Law for 8 seasons.
Yes.
8 seasons.
Yes.
And then you decided, okay, this is it, I'm calling it a day.
Yeah.
You know, trying to explore something different. Was it difficult to get different roles and, you know, to step out of the shadow?
The hardest experience in my life because in my country, if you're in one show, it's hard for you to get other shows. You don't get roles in other shows. They feel like it's competing.
Wow.
So when I left the show, I left at the top. Right? And I thought, you know, I'm Selena. I'm going to be a boss.
Yeah.
I mean, producers will be calling, directors. You know, they need me. No one called.
Huh.
I was jobless for 2 years.
Oh my goodness.
That's when I had that moment. I decided, you know what? If they don't give me roles, I'm going to create one for myself. So I created the show, Suna Journey. And Jesus. I played lead.
Yes.
I wasn't playing. Yes. Yeah. I will create the show and I'm playing lead in the show. Yeah. It's my show.
Yeah. Do you still find that people call you Selena till this day?
They do. My son calls me Selena sometimes.
What? No. Selena!
What? Yeah, it's a canon thing. Once you play a role very well, I believe I did, it sticks. I get endorsements and they want to use Selena.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I've tried to fight it, but I'm like, as long as I make my money, I'm good. I'm good. If it brings me money, I'm good. They can call me Selena forever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
You know what, Sharon? I mean, you were in Olotore as well as Glamour Girls. And when we look at the roles in those particular shows, it was quite evident that, you know, that they're very different from your typical roles that you've played before. Was that a very conscious effort on your part to not be typecast and to show that you've got that range?
Girl, no matter how conscious you are about being typecast, the industry is what it is.
No.
So like Kate said, you have to almost struggle to break out of your stereotype, right? Mm. And Olotire was like breaking out of my stereotype, I believe. And I'd say it was really hard because, just like she said, I know what I look like. Mm. I know when I walk into a room, I know the energy that I would bring. Mm. But how many people see beyond that? How many people see the passion? Mm-hmm. Because acting is you putting yourself in another person's shoes, right? Mm. So, and that's what you are as an actor. You're willing to tell other people's stories with your full, like my country, say with your full chest, which means with everything you have. Mm. So obviously, Olotire and Glamour Girls were very different roles. I would consider them me still breaking out, which is what I think I'm still doing.
Nice.
They were both hard. They both took a lot from me because in Olotire, I had to play a journalist, right? Mm. Who was going undercover. Now in Glamour Girls, I was a gutter snipe who was genuinely trying to struggle to make it to the top. And you know, when you're me and in real life, you're just happy, you're happy-go-lucky. And then you have to put yourself in the shoes of someone who's not eating. Mm. Then you realize that you're in a bubble.
Mm.
And that's what acting does. It brings you back to reality.
Yeah. Mm.
When you play certain roles, you realize that, oh my God, my life is very, you're so privileged. Mm. So you see things from a very different lens when you play roles. That's why I'm so happy that I'm an actor. I get to live other people's lives and yet be very understanding.
100%.
So those two roles, as painful and dramatic as they both were for me, they helped me as a person and as an actor. Because my mindset has a bit of a shift.
Mm.
You know, when I see people, I understand them differently.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah,
you know, when people say things, they're saying things from their perspective, from their experience.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you're able to live that as an actor, you understand people more.
Yeah.
So when someone says something, you know, this person is projecting.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you get what I mean? Yeah, it's not about you. You know, this person is projecting.
Yeah.
So
that's
what being an actor has made me become very understanding. I know when you say stuff, it's not me, don't worry.
Yeah. Mm.
I've lived it by someone else.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's not me, it's you.
It's you.
Okay. Listen, the tea's only just warming up. We have so much more in store for you with our lovely trio here, okay? But first off, here's a look at Sharon as the brave Olotore.
What thing happened where you just sit down like this? Eh? Any problem?
No. Are they okay?
Ah! Now who do you like this? Nachuks? Why you go to do like this now?
Na me vex up.
Blessing, why you still there with this guy? Blessing, you don't need him anymore. You no need them. Make you just leave this guy. Eh? Why not just do like other girls? Join all these apps them like Lover's Zoom.
He gonna kill me now. We plenty way there here before. And now only me remain. So I know say he gonna kill me if I try to come on. Who sent me?
Now, Sharon, I mean, we just spoke now at length about people will say whatever they want. They have got no filter whatsoever. And when Oluture launched, there were a lot of people that were saying, you know, why is it Sharon? There should be someone else that is cast over here. Considering, you know, the amount of effort that goes into your role, you don't just show up on set and there you are. There's so much prep that goes into it, so much passion and the love. How do those comments make you feel?
So because there's something that filming Oluture taught me. Passion pushes you. It's like you're a moving train. You don't even know that you're moving that fast. And I knew that they would come for me.
Sure.
Because that's what happens when you're being stereotyped. But you have to prepare yourself to break. That's why it's called a break. Something will crack, right? So obviously, I already knew that I was going to be on the other end of the stick, just standing strong. I know the effort I put into that character. I lost about 3 kg. I got 3 shades darker because of the sun. I had a sprained ankle for a full year and a half. So with all this effort, and then because I had to do a lot of research for that role, like I said, going in, digging deep and seeing that this is real life. People are being trafficked. There was a mind shift. So I realized that this was for a greater cause. Above me just being an actor, I was passing on a message, right? There's a reality. This is someone's reality. Someone is being sold somewhere for the hope of a better life. So that in itself, knowing that I was the tool used to create this awareness, I received some backlash, as much as I received a lot of praises. But like my mom would say to me, don't stay in a moment of victory and look for who is not clapping for you. That's how she says it. You stay where they are clapping.
Come on.
And that's what I did. I stood where they were clapping. Period.
Sure. That's powerful.
Yeah.
I need to take that in.
Purr.
Listen. You know what? In Oluture, being that it is in, you know, the world of sex work, I'm pretty sure there's a lot of preparation that is required for that because there's hella intimate scenes. How do you prepare for that?
So, I had to remove Sharon, who is the prude. and say, Sharon, this is not you. This is Oluture. And she that character would do anything to reveal what was going on in the underworld, right? So I had to tell myself, do you know what? For it to be real, you have to look uncomfortable. And that's what happens when these girls are getting raped, when they're taking advantage of someone. So as I think the fact that it was such an evasive process worked for me. And there was a scene where Oluture got raped, right? The director didn't want me to cry. Because it was one of those scenes where you're in so much pain, tears are the last thing on your mind. It's survival. Because it's beyond. So that scene, if you look at it, I was fighting back tears because director says, do not cry. So there's a lot of things going on because naturally, Sharon, me, I'm a very emotional person. So for me, it was like, okay, hold, this is not Sharon. Hold back and be strong because right now this girl is getting raped. So like I said, it's evasive, but I, if I do say so myself, I pulled through.
And you know, being in showbiz, there are a lot of intimate scenes that you're going to have to do. You're getting, you know, close and intimate with a co-star at some stages, you know what I mean? So how do you, you know, get over that hurdle? And also, what if you don't want to? What if you're feeling like, hey, I'm not, you know, I'm not comfortable with this particular scene? How do you ladies handle that?
So for me, I would say I look beyond myself. I'm looking at the end product because where I come from, my country, they're very vocal about feedback.
Gotcha.
So nobody is going to be there to say, oh my God, you were uncomfortable, Lou. They'll just say she cannot act. That's how they'll put it. So you're thinking, hey, this is me trying to pass a message across, right? So I have to take it. It's temporary. This is not my everyday life. It's a few minutes of this thing. So I will give it my best shot. Because that's what we are as actors. We are feelers. You feel your environment. You feel the emotion of the person in front of you. So even if I don't like you, that's not Sharon. That's the character. So I'm going to take it for that character.
Candice?
Oh, so I had my very first intimate scene when I was still in the telenovela that I was on. Luckily, it was with a co-star who was a very good friend of mine. So if anything, it felt like a dance. It felt like someone I could trust. And I think one of the greatest privileges you could have as an artist is being in a space where you feel seen, but also safe with your co-artist. So him and I had been, and what made it even strange is that at the time, my character was 18. So I'm playing, so I'm, first thing is representing the young story well.
True.
So without throwing away a moment as intimate as that, and if anything, making it crass or crude, I had to keep the innocence of that moment. So it was beautiful to have someone who entrusted me with that, to have a story, and you know, writers who entrusted me with that story. And then Jaiva happened. And then I had an intimate scene with the incredible Untate Saint Cecily, who is a legendary actor. So someone who I respect and revere. And one thing I'm also very grateful for is that in South Africa, it's imperative that you have an intimacy coach on set. So someone who's willing to guide you through that and to also choreograph the scene. A great thing, I was fatigued. It was a 4 a.m. scene after 12 hours of shooting. So firstly, I was exhausted. But also the beautiful thing about storytelling is having the opportunity to play in those moments. So Dr. Saint was very respectful in that moment. And I think if anything, gave me the freedom to immerse myself in that, especially because the scene was comical. So it was less about the intimacy and less about it being this innately sexy moment, but more about this slay queen, for lack of a better term, who's having to pay her dues. And it's just another another box she's ticking, like, okay, let's go. Wrap it up, wrap it up. And yeah, I appreciated that moment.
Sure. You know, Kate, I've realized, you know, that in Brother Jekyll as well as Disconnect, you usually almost are always the funny girl in the room, right?
Yeah.
Do you think then that comedy almost shields you from having the risque and intimate moments?
I think it does. Let me correct you. The chubby, funny girl.
That's that part.
Yeah, but I think it does. And like, I like these two. I struggle so much with the intimate scene because I come from a very conservative society. And I'm a mom to a teenager. My son is 15. So I struggle with that. But like Sharon said, it's beyond me as Catherine. It's me telling the story. And I mean, I bring my son on set. He knows exactly how such scenes are shot. So I'm trying to, like, you know, give them as much information. So they correct people. And, oh, I saw your mom being kissed on TV. Like, no, this is how they shoot it. So he is the one educating I'm getting there. So the next one, I'm definitely going all out.
And what kind of conversation do you think you'll need to have with your son if you have to go all the way?
If I have to go all the way, it's like, we read scripts together.
Is it?
We prepare. Yes, we prepare.
Brilliant.
He's on set. So yeah, so that's what I'm going to do now. And that's on that. Like, I'm going to get it.
You know what, Candice? You know what I loved about your character, Uvuyisa, on Jaiva, is that she went through a journey of depending on a man first and then finding her independence. Did you find anything you can pull from and get inspired from when it comes to playing Vuyiswa and that journey?
Oh, one thing that I really love, not only about Vuyiswa, but about the stories on Jaiva, is that for the very first time, you see five women as leads that are autonomous beings.
That's true.
And not often enough are we firstly seeing black women leading stories, but also seeing them being the architects of their own narrative. And Vuyiswa was a very beautiful, bold representation of that. I think very often, especially in the South African context, we've kind of dirtied the term slay queen.
Firstly,
it was taking back the power on what it means to slay and what it means to be a queen. And yes, the circumstances may have been unfavorable in terms of what she was going through and what she was experiencing. But the fact that she was able to own her power and own her narrative and own that journey was also humanizing a character like that. And I think that's also the responsibility that we have as artists, is to humanize that experience so that, yes, if I am typecast in this particular role, lest we forget I'm a three-dimensional human being having a human experience. So Vuyiswa cries. Vuyiswa has ambitions. Vuyiswa loves to dance. Vuyiswa has that tug of war. She has her own hero's journey. And how can I best represent that in a way where, yes, she may have been independent, but she is a hero in the end of the story without having to succumb to the hero or having to have the savior complex with another man.
Got you.
Do you know something else that Vuyiswa also is? She's never listened to by her older man.
Then there's that.
Yeah, almost sees Vuyiswa as a trophy, you know, outside of everything else. And I wonder if you relate to that in real life, you know, that people will often just look at the beauty before they deeper.
Is there some tea in here? It's an invisible tea.
I feel like some tea is gonna be spilled.
Do I feel like I experience that in real life? I think I do. And it normally presents itself in the form of people. And I know, I remember Sharon and I were having this conversation where people say, oh, you're actually a lot more nicer in real life, or a lot more intelligent, or there's nuances to your character or your personality that are pleasantly surprising, as if the casing is an embodiment of what the content is. And yes, that's why I said, and I mentioned, and I'm very self-aware. I know of what I know what I look like, and I've said it before. I mean, I've said on my channel that if you don't know what what's packaged, you know, you won't know what your scent is. And for me, I like to be the pleasant surprise in the room. So I don't, I'm not at a point anymore where I'm so attached to ego, where those things are insulting, or those things are remotely offensive. I'm just like, I will keep being a pleasant surprise. When I open my mouth, you will hear an intelligent woman. And take a page from my lead. Like, take a leaf from the book if you're invested. If you're not, it's all on you.
Do you feel like maybe that sometimes you find yourself maybe overcompensating, so you don't want people to just see that? You want to give them more. I'm intelligent. I'm blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean?
Not anymore. I think probably now in my life, I don't feel the pressure as much. Hence, I think it's okay for me to take the role that may seem like it's a little too easy. Or it's on the nose. It's like, because I've done the work. So I don't feel like I'm at a point anymore I need to prove myself. If anything, it's just immersing myself in what I love to do. And honoring the gift that God has given me as a storyteller.
I like that. I really like that. You know what, Kate? You know, your career is quite expansive, being that you've got to work in Kenya and also in Nollywood as well. And not many actors get to be that crossover. You know what I mean? So what do you think these industries can learn from one another?
I think we need each other. We need to collaborate for us to get where we want to get, you know, in the global. We need to work together. And it was such a beautiful experience. Even me just being here with Candice, being with Sharon again. We're seeing the possibilities, like, what can we become? We created a clip yesterday, the other day, with Bimbo, and it's gone viral. It's
like, I saw that.
A million.
I saw that.
That is the power that we have.
Yes.
Imagine if we did that. I love your industry. I love Cindy Lato. I love you. She's my friend. Cindy. And I would love to have such collaborations.
I would love.
Yeah, we are bigger. Sure. We are stronger together.
We're stronger together.
Yeah. 100%. Kate, you know, speaking of viral videos, somebody in your position and your level of stardom, it's quite rare to see them be so open on social media. And I mean, literally, you share a lot of yourself with the public.
Yeah.
Why are you so open with your audience?
Because I think I made a promise to God. Okay, let me start the story. I got pregnant at 19. The stigma that comes with that, the shame. You know, people gave up on me, disappointment. And I made a pact with God, like, if he gets me through this, like, I will tell my story. And I'm a mentor to very many teen moms. And I feel like I owe them that, to save them from that.
True.
So I made a pact with God to share my story as an inspiration and to let girls know, like, you know, you can go through these things and still become someone in society. So I'm not scared to tell my story. I'm not scared to tell my story. I'll tell it over and over and over again. But I've learned with time, I have my limits as to sharing. Like, you'll never see me, oh, welcome to my house, oh, this is me. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. But now, unless it's something like it's mentorship or inspiration, I'm going to tell it.
Do you think you've gotten over the shame aspect, you know, being a teenage pregnancy, especially in a conservative community?
Girl, look at me.
Come on, girl.
I'll keep crying for you.
I have, because it was such a journey. It was such a journey. And I own that story.
Yeah.
And I'm so proud of myself. I'm so proud of the people on my support system. I'm so proud of my son. I show him off all the time. So, I mean, I'm over it. I'm over it. Yes.
Sure.
Yeah.
You know what, Sharon? One thing I've noticed about Nollywood, you know, as an industry, is that it's quite obsessed with the get married before 30. That narrative, right? And also, who you're dating as well, right?
Girl.
So, you know, how do you handle that stress, that pressure, and also trying to speak out about it as well?
Girl, first of all, I was saying the other day at dinner, something in my head has snapped. So you see that marriage talk?
Yes.
Yeah, it's entering here, it's coming out to the other one. Because I would say, yes, there was a point in my life where I was pressured. Mm. I did feel the pressure. But I think as you grow older, you realize that this is a lifetime and you don't want to play with your lifetime.
True.
That is why the power is in your hands to choose wisely. So I'm not going to let anybody pressure me into meeting the right person. Mm. He would find me, right?
Sure.
And we would get there. But at the same time, personally, I just don't like sharing.
Mm.
Because I feel like I share so much of me. That's what you are as an artist with the world. Mm. There has to be some part of you that you hold sacred.
Yeah.
Right? Mm. And I repeat, we are feelers. As an actor, once you're emotionally strained, it affects your work.
Yeah. I don't know about you, and I don't know about you.
Oh, yeah.
So I protect my emotional life. I make sure that it's something that you're not going to have this aspect.
Mm.
By God's grace, my husband, I might share a little bit. But I don't know how much of him I will share.
Mm.
But for now, you're not going to know what I'm up to. Mm. And because it's news. And I want to be in the news for my craft.
Yeah.
I want to be in the news for getting this role and killing it. I want to be in the news for changing something, doing something great, being a great, amazing, strong woman.
Mm.
I'm not, I don't want to be in the news because of a relationship and some and a man.
True, true. Mm.
Which is the regular.
Mm. Yeah.
Right? Like we said, I know what I am.
Mm.
And there's so much more to me than being in a relationship. So yeah, because I've had someone tweet about me before and say she lacks depth.
Oh, hectic.
Guess what? I waited for a few years later when I had worked on myself, because I knew that that was the early stages of my career. And I tweeted back when I knew that I had done the work.
Yeah.
Sure.
But she didn't know it was for her, but I know she read it. And I said, yeah, depth is digging, and digging takes time. So you're not going to just hit and say, oh yeah, the hole is, no, you would dig to get the depth that you need. And I knew that I would get there, so I was patient. So here I am now, honey, giving you the depth you need on a Netflix platform. Thank you, honey. Thank you, honey.
Are you a Scorpio? Because that level
of techniques.
I meant to reply to you. So I get it.
I'm a very happy Aries. Yeah. But because, like I said, I'm emotional, it got to me.
Yeah.
Because no matter how strong you say you are, I don't care what anybody says, you're human.
Mm. Yes.
You're, like I said, we're actors, we're feelers.
Yeah. Sure. Mm.
So sometimes those things actually strike a chord. I'm like, am I really that?
Am I shallow?
What vibe and what energy am I giving up? And I just realized that it was part of the stereotype thing.
Yeah.
When they keep seeing you in certain roles, she cannot do more than this now. And that's where it came from.
Yeah.
So now in hindsight, I don't blame her. I understand her. You know, I understand where she was coming from, but she can never say that again.
Yeah.
And you know what, what's quite interesting about your career is that, you know, you started off in modeling and you said that acting came as somewhat of a beautiful mistake, right? So do you think, you know, the negative comments somewhat play into your imposter syndrome and reinforces that, and you always have to reset yourself that I'm here on purpose?
Yes. I see why I'm here. I know exactly why I'm here. In fact, I have, although I didn't know that this was going to be my path, when I look back as a child, this was always me. I would stand in front of the TV and be mimicking people.
Sure.
Yeah. I always wanted to wear makeup. I would be the child to pick my Christmas dress. I would cry if my dress wasn't pretty.
Yeah.
So I knew that this showbiz business was for me. But at the same time, I was here for the purpose of telling stories. So yes, imposter syndrome is real.
Sure. Yeah.
Because I feel like I literally just came out of, I've come out of it. I'm stronger. I just came out of it because you question yourself a lot as an actor. I don't know if you do behind closed doors. You question yourself, but you get to a point where you're like, nah.
No,
I am that thing.
Yeah, you are the girl you think
I am. I am the girl I think I am. There's so, like, and I say this with so much joy, there's so much to me.
Yeah.
Yes.
And the people who miss out on me is on you.
You're lost.
Yeah, less.
So when imposter syndrome does kick in, right, who do you call to remind you of who you are? Who's the first phone call?
I remember when I transitioned from TV acting to film, which are two different things. And I got my first role as a supporting actor, actress. And I kept questioning myself. Am I ready? Can I even go this deep? Sure. It's called Nafsi. It's a story on surrogacy. Two friends, and I decide to be the surrogate for my friend. Mm. And my friend is a brilliant actress. Her name is Mumbi Maina. She's on Matrix. Mm. And she made me so comfortable.
Wow.
She kept reassuring me even when I had doubts. Wow. And I bagged the best actress just last week, in 2 weeks ago. So amazing. But that is creeps in sometimes. Mm. But yeah. I have to keep reminding myself that I am the girl I think I
Come
am.
Come on.
And I'm here to stay.
Come
and
on.
Film, I mean TV film, I mean put me, I'm a silver siren queen.
Come on.
Yes.
Silver screen queen, that's it.
It's in the name.
It's in the name, darling.
Love it. Candice, who's your first phone call?
Oh, without being too philosophical.
Okay.
I call on God,
child. Come on. You better preach.
No, yeah, I really do.
Holy Spirit, activate.
Holy Spirit, activate. Holy Spirit. I know, honestly speaking, because sometimes you never want to put too much faith in everyone else.
Yeah.
Because it may not always be available to you.
Mm. Yes.
And one of the greatest piece of advice that I got from one of my lecturers, Charlie Adler, incredible voice actor. Mm. If anything, the legend of voice acting. And he said, you should always believe that you're standing on solid ground.
Sure.
And that solid ground is my years of experience. So in moments where I do find myself dwelling in imposter syndrome, I look at the years of experience that have to speak for themselves. And then when it gets tough, I have my mom and my two older sisters.
Yeah.
And I actually have countless people, my friends.
Yeah.
But then I also have just years of work and a love and, like you mentioned, passion.
Yeah.
And passion always, like, faith and love can always filter out fear.
Yeah.
Especially if you're willing to commit yourself to that process. Mm. Not easy, but it's worth it.
Yeah.
Sure. Now, Kate, you had mentioned a little bit earlier, you know, that you share a lot, you know, because this is your gift. You've got to share it. But you're also very selective about what it is that you are sharing on social media platforms. Mm-hmm. And there was an incident that happened where you shared your opinions on single motherhood. Explosion on social media.
So she's wearing a bulletproof vest today.
Was that an a confusing experience for you at the very least?
It was, because I was very new on Twitter. And single motherhood. I was a single mom for the longest time, and that's what I was known as, right?
Wow.
And a champion for the rights of teen moms. And I was trying to, like, educate young girls, because there's this narrative, like, being a single mom, teen mom, is cute. You know, they see Kylie Jenner and her baby, and she's a billionaire.
Period.
Hello. Right? Yeah. And I was trying to communicate that you're not as privileged as Kylie Jenner is. Being a teen mom is ghetto. It messes with your self-esteem. It messes with you. You're not ready for that. So I was trying to say, let's try and not glamorize it.
Mm.
But of course, I think my language was awful. Oh, my phone. They came from Kenya on Twitter.
Yeah.
Kenya's on Twitter is one of the harshest.
Really?
Harshest ever. But then when they love you, they'll support you. But I got it. I got it and I learned. So now I watch my language. I reread, proofread. Okay, can I tweet?
Okay.
Everyone must read it first.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
Sheesh, man.
Yeah, but the message got home. Yeah.
That's what's important.
Yes.
Depends who you are.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
You educated me as well just now.
Yes. I mean, are there any roles where you were offered and you looked at them, you auditioned, you're like, this role? I need to speak to my family.
Yeah.
Actually, I might not even take it because of my family.
Yeah.
Was there, you're shaking your head.
Yes. There was one, actually. What show is this on Netflix? My friend ended up getting the role. It had a bit of intimate scenes. And they were very, after I watched the scene, I was like, it was never for me.
Really?
I couldn't have done it. I couldn't have done it because of what I explained earlier.
Yeah.
Because there's these standards that I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just like, but I'm willing to break away now.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Now, if you give it to me, like, I'm going to play it.
Hey.
Yes. But I had to, like, I was praying that I don't get the role.
And I let me make this audition as bad as possible.
Yeah. I know I performed, but I was just like, please, I don't think I'm ready. Yeah. Yeah.
Candice?
Look, at the time, there was a role. And initially, how she was written, I already knew that it would be very stereotypical of me to take a role like that. So already, the initial scene is she gets out of bed. She's having conversation with her fiancé. And she's in the mirror, but she's in lingerie. And for me, nudity needs to be earned or intentional.
100%.
I like that.
And I've just felt like that's the first introduction for the character. I already knew how they were trying to set me up. And at the time, I think it was around 25, very early stages of my career. And I was still on youth TV, which made it even worse. So I was very responsible for representing young people well, but also not over-sexualizing myself. So I was able to step away from that. Now I probably would take that role, but it just felt like...
Why
does she need to do that? And I was like, look, it's inevitable that there are going to be countless scenes where she's just walking past and we're zooming into parts of her body that are unjustified, like other soapies that are on the TV screens that shall not be named.
I actually want to get into, because you've mentioned, you know, your experience, what is that we've been chatting about. And do you feel that as ladies, there might still be a double standard where... For the guys, for men, it's like, take your t-shirt off and you can do a scene. It's like, yes.
100%.
All the eyes rolling,
Because it's different for women. 100%. But as a woman, you're not going to walk into a room, even if it's 60 people in the crew, you're not going to walk in, mind my friend, your titties hanging, everybody's not going to, they'll be like, woo. Right? But whereas a man will walk in and some girls will be like, okay. And at the same time, you're trying to, it's for a role. But you're like, how am I supposed to strike this balance without feeling uncomfortable? If the crew is feeling uncomfortable, then what is the crowd going to do when they watch it? So like she said, it has to be extremely intentional. For me, I have to, me and the director would have conversations. Director, is it necessary that this is shot like this? Or if not, like for Olotre, for instance, they got me a body double because it was very important that the girls were naked in the coffin. So for the, I said I would do everything else, the rape, the everything. But you see that nudity? That stark nudity, I can't do. And plus, where I come from in Nigeria, we our standards, we are culturally, it's just still very much unacceptable. Except you're trying to genuinely say, start using me for porn, literally. That's what would happen. That's it. Because it wouldn't do good for you. It wouldn't do any good for my career if I did that. It would be a backlash.
In my country, it means losing endorsements even.
Because
I am a family brand. So they'd be like, take her off, happy, take her off everything. Yeah, so it's still very conservative.
So do you think you have control of your career in some sort, in terms of where you can go? Or do you think you're not in control in some level, in some way?
I am trying to get there. And the only way is I gotta make money, sweetie.
The coin decide.
I don't need to rely on this, you know, corporates and stuff like that to start doing my own thing. I think I'm trying to get there. Hectic.
It kind of pains me because I understand the constant balance and balancing act that you guys have to do, you know? And I also don't want to get into it being a pretty privileged pity party, right? But I do want to know, you know, do you experience pretty privilege, you know, being that you are beautiful, beautiful woman? And is there a dark side to that pretty privilege that you also have?
Sharon, I'm going to let you. We've had this conversation at great lengths over the past couple of days.
My love, you know you're my twin. I will let you take this one. Take it for the team, honey.
Look, if I may segue into the other end, right? I have experienced pretty privilege. I'm aware of the pretty privilege. I've been intentional in the roles that I take from the onset of my career. That again, the skill set. Can Candice act, yes or no? As to whether she's slim, thick, or whatever it is, for me, that was highly irrelevant. But I also recognize as a producer and a director the responsibility that I have to position women in a way where they are as multifaceted, as truthful, and as authentic as possible. So how am I casting? How am I thinking? How am I writing? How am I... for example, I think we're very... I think we like to hide behind this concept of being a conservative country.
Yeah.
But I think as producers, we still have a lot of internal biases yeah. that mm-hmm. we don't like to address.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we will yes. more likely yeah. cast the person that is the cookie cutter, clean, conventional version of beautiful.
Yeah.
And colorism. Then like, so we have our yes. colorism.
Yeah.
We are also, there is a lot of fat phobia in our industry.
Yeah.
And then it's like what you mentioned, yeah. when you are size 36 plus,
yeah.
I don't think the chubby woman owes you comedy.
Yeah. Mm. Do you know what I mean?
And when we do teet on something remotely controversial,
yeah.
we're not creating three-dimensional characters and yeah. we're sprinkling them on stories like parsley.
Yeah. Mm.
And I don't think that's fair. So I think from that stance, I'm mindful of the pretty privilege that I've experienced,
yeah.
but also on the other end, how I can become a lot more responsible. Creating... And I think also, if I may also mention, where are the trans characters?
Mm-hmm.
There aren't enough trans women.
Yeah.
There isn't enough trans representation. Mm. There isn't enough representation of women with albinism in our stories.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think we're also ableist in our storytelling because 100%. Where are the people that are differently abled in our stories and yeah. why they're not leading these stories?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I had a conversation with a friend not too long ago and I was like, Chomi, when last did you see someone in a wheelchair in a story? When last did you see someone who is impaired with their hearing or their sight?
Yeah.
We don't see enough of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we don't see enough of that not only in storytelling as a whole, in the women, in the leads.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think there's very different ways you can approach it. I try to find the easiest way to run away from your pretty privileged story, and there it is.
That's pretty privileged answer. I was like, yeah. all right.
I can relate with her yeah. because yeah. like, if I go back to what she's saying, we realize that TV is a sensitization tool.
Mm.
Majority of the things we watched when we were growing up literally etched the kind of people that we are today.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm.
So if we're trying to change the narrative, we have to change it with the way we're thinking, right?
Yes.
I'm not going to take away the fact that I'm a beautiful woman and I'm not going to dumb myself down because you think it should work. It will not work against me. What I will do is show you that I am more than that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? And everybody is beautiful
yeah.
in their own way.
Mm.
So yes, I have experienced pretty privilege a lot of times, but at the same time, it has worked against me because it's like, because she looks like this. So what do you want me to do? What do you want me to do?
I'm treating myself.
What do you want me to do? I'm treating myself for you.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah.
And I don't know whether this question ties up with colorism as well.
Yes. Or and I watch big fan of it.
Yeah, because in my country, like we've had us darker skin girls have had to really fight for lead roles.
Sure. Mm.
Because when they're casting, they're like, oh, this story, what's the story? Oh, a beautiful woman. And immediately for the director is light skin.
You know?
And everything. Yeah. We've had to fight so hard to get these lead roles. And I had to write for a lead role myself.
Mm.
Wow. You know? But we're getting there. I'm seeing a change. There's been a positive change towards that.
Mm. And you know what I will also say in terms of how women are represented in stories when we are eventually the leads.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so blessed to listen to a panel yesterday where they were speaking about the lack of representation in terms of women in particular industries, like your STEM subjects, your science, your technology, your engineering and your maths.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So when they're leads, but they are also fashion designers.
Yeah. Yes.
So it's very stereotypical in terms of what women are capable of doing in the industries as the character.
Mm-hmm.
And that, I remember growing up on the soapy diet. So everyone knows if you watch a particular soapy, you kind of aspire to be that.
Yeah. Yeah.
If I'm watching you and you're this multimillionaire lawyer, I look up to you.
Exactly.
Yes, you're a fictional character, but I'm also seeing the capacity and the capabilities of what women are able to do.
Yeah.
So we keep stunting young women's imaginations because we are saying that women can only be this because this is what storytelling is showcasing, not only in the real world, but also through our stories.
Mm. Yeah.
And I think we need to be a lot more daring and audacious in how we are saying lead women can also be scientists.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The story can be around, I'm a romantic interest, but I'm also an engineer.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had a conversation talking about how you can create passion without physical touch.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Yes, there's so much as an actor you can do to create anticipation for. I'm watching Bridgerton season two at the moment. I'm anticipating, okay, can they get there?
Mm-hmm.
Nobody has touched.
Yeah.
Guess what? Nobody has touched anyone.
Yeah.
But I like that.
Yeah.
Because that is the real intimacy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Guess what? The whole sexualization thing is the end bit of what intimacy represents. And that's why I would take myself a little bit back to what you talked about, what I wouldn't take as an actor, because there are a lot of young girls that are looking up to me. And I want them to understand that you're beautiful. You're sexy. But that doesn't even scratch the surface of who you are. So in my roles, because I'm being intentional about what I'm trying to teach these girls, for now I can't do that. A time will get there when I'm like, okay, you know, but for now, since they are watching glued, let me just be the foundation for them. This is like, I'm like their, you know, safety net for now. Fall here, you're safe. This is how we'll be doing it. I will do it together.
I mean, being on a show like Mother-in-Law, eighth season, in a lead role, as a dark-skinned woman, what kind of impact did that have? Did you get any sort of proof or evidence of that impact in young girls who look like you?
I think that's why my role, like, I blew out. I think that was the reason, because for the longest time it was always the lighter skin.
You know, they always go like, but we also suffer. People think you're blonde, but it's not.
I think that's why Selena was so big, because for the first time the girls were saying, oh, I'm dark skinned. I'm curvy. And she's doing well, and she's here. It was me and my friend, Mumbi Minor, who I saw, and I was like, you know what? If she can do it, I can do it. So we have been, we're like, I don't know what to say, guinea pigs or what to say. We're like, you can do it. We're telling the story differently. So I think that's why I blew up. It was an opportunity. And I remember the conversation was, she's so cute for a dark-skinned girl. Like, these are our people saying that. I can't mention, right? It was on set. Like, she's cute, like, for a dark skinned girl.
It's crazy. Sure.
Now, one thing that we have all got in common really is rejection. Candice touched on it a little bit earlier. A year ago, Andy and I were down at the river singing our praises, trying to get over things. You know what I mean? But I can imagine that rejection must be a little bit different. You know, Kate, you have got a wealth of experience. You know what I mean? And there were times that you've been rejected that you still would get rejected. How do you deal with that? And how is it something that you really try and overcome?
I was rejected 2 weeks ago before I came here. I really, really wanted that role. But you know what? It was on a different network. So I'm glad I'm here. I'm on Netflix.
You've leveled up.
I've leveled up. I think when you sign up, that's what you sign up for in this industry. And you have to be ready. I take every audition as an experience. That's how I grow.
That's a nice perspective.
That rejection is like redirection, what you say. Like, it's growth for me. So I'm like, it wasn't meant for me. Mine is coming. My role will choose me. And I'm good with that. But of course, it has come with experience. Starting out, I was like, oh my God, am I not pretty enough? Am I not strong enough? You know? But now I'm like, I got this. It's okay. It wasn't mine. Oh my God. I'm bigger than that.
It's amazing how we're thinking the same thought.
I love this.
In that rejection thing, I don't even think I want to share that story. Because everybody sounds so strong about the rejection. I don't think I was that strong.
Your story matters.
What happened? I think I was rejected so many times. There was this one rejection I got 2 years ago. I cried. I was crying in front of them. I was like, okay, why not me? Now I've gone for this audition. They said, okay, you're gonna get it. The next thing, they don't call me back after a week. Then they call me back and say, okay, now we're going to give this amount of money because the director says you're light-skinned. I say,
what?
What does that have to do with anything? Then shortly after, my friend calls me, oh my God, I've been cast for this role. And this is supposed to be one of my best friends. So I'm sitting there, I have to celebrate her because this is something I wanted as well. So you sit down and you're like, this is my friend. I have to celebrate her because we want to grow together. But at the same time, I'm like, what kind of rejection is that? You didn't even call to tell me, oh, we do not want you. It is the worst type of silent rejection. So I just didn't get it. I couldn't wrap my head around it, and I couldn't say I didn't want the film to do well because my best friend was in it. So it was a tough place to be in.
That's insane.
Girl. That's when you guys are like, oh, I just keep it. I said, you kept on moving. I cried. See, let me tell you, I cried so much that my mom was like, see, maybe you should just, I said, quit words. I will stay, but I'll cry this cry. I'll cry. 3 days later, I wake up in the morning, I'm like, Lord, it's me again. So you mean this film has just passed me? So it's gone? And guess what? It turned out it's one of the best Netflix originals I've watched.
Wow. So I'm like, thank God my friend was in it. It was a win for the team.
Yes.
Because not trying to sound rude, because another person I would have been hitting on the field. But my best girl was in it. So I'm like, your girl's a lovely film.
Yeah.
But I cried.
Jeepers.
I cried.
And that's a very real thing. Yeah. I like that you actually opened up about that.
I cried.
No, your tears are literally, your eyes are glossing up right now. We can actually see it.
I'm like, makeup.
Yeah, I got you.
But you know what hurts me, no? Yeah. What hurts me is the fact that you got the ugliness, you know, and there was no tenderness in terms of, hey, we've decided to go a different direction.
Yeah.
No. At least the tenderness.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
I do that. Yeah.
Do you think you get, because you are pretty girls and people think, ah, it's you get the ugliness of the industry and people use you as just the dots. You're a dot ball, basic dot board. True. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You walk into your mind, you feel that energy, don't you?
No. In the outside African industry, I don't think it's necessarily because you're pretty, but they're literally not going to let you know.
Yeah. Wow, lucky you.
No, they're not. So you will audition. Mm-hmm. You can go through callbacks, Love and Light. You'll see it on...
Yeah.
I'm surprised.
No, Love and Light. Exactly. No, wow, it's Love and Light.
Like, you just see the series. You're like, wait, who got the
It can be an ad. And literally the next day, you'll see it on screen.
So it's not even about the feedback. When you walk in, you feel the energy.
Yeah.
It's like she said because she's fine.
Yeah.
That's it. When you know I'm here because in broken English, I sabi act. I can act.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm here. And I know, because that imposter thing makes you feel like you can't, but you know you can. So when you're already struggling, is it because I'm fine, they're not giving me this? Or is it because... So that, to be honest, I don't care about the feedback these days. Yeah. I'm like, that's your business.
It's true.
You say I'll be your face.
Yeah.
And guess what? I'm in your face on FX.
Has there ever been a point where you wished you weren't pretty? Because when you're not... conventionally pretty,
never.
Then you get the deeper stories.
Can I give you my answer?
Yes.
No. We stay pretty all day.
You're like, here, please.
I can say I have. I genuinely
really?
Have.
Really?
Yeah, and it's not even to trivialize or to say, oh no, it has nothing to do with that. But I remember not really understanding the body that I was in primarily because I'm very small.
Yes.
I'm a very small person. And at the time, you know, auditioning for roles where obviously on a brief, you'll get 18 to 25.
Yeah.
Now, you guys know what 24-year-olds look like right now.
Yes.
And at the time, I'm like 21 and I'm auditioning looking like a 14-year-old.
Oh,
so it was inevitable at that moment, especially because there was this obsession with being racially ambiguous as well. So here are all these women walking into the space, 24, looking like this hourglass model. And here's dainty little me who really can act. And I promise you guys, I can prove to you. Just look past the fact that I look like a child.
If you just put me in the room.
Put me in the room. And I was in the room and I wasn't booking the work. And that's when I really had to have the solid conversation with myself about understanding the gift and understanding the timing as well and accepting it for what it was. Difficult, but it was a difficult chat with myself about also just the physical appearance and it not being the primary aspect of my work.
And also, I just want to, before I close, right, there's always the but aspect when it comes to your talent. There's a talented but, pretty but. What is the one but you just like, if I could face you right now, no cameras, no evidence, and you say that to me, it's a brawl.
It's that depth thing. Where I just think, oh, she looks pretty, but that's where I'm an actor. I'm a canvas. Paint on me, darling. You see a canvas, that's why I am plain. What do you want to paint on me? You are my director. You are the script writer. That is why I will give you anything. So don't limit me with your mind, but she's fair, but she's slim, but she... Can she speak pidgin English? She can't act a local role. We can't dumb her down. How do you know that? Who told you that I'm not willing to cut my hair? Who told you? There's these questions you haven't asked, right? So for me,
absolutely.
When you haven't asked, you're not allowed to just limit me. So that's it from that. But like, you can see it in my face when you're doing as nice as I am. You will genuinely see it in my face.
and it's a depth thing for me too. And I think I overcame it when I got my role. Nafsi, the one I just talked about. And I went all out. It took a toll on me, and I was like, oh, there's depth.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, I want to come in here because I'm wondering, you know, you're talking a lot about depth and stuff, and I don't hear it happening to a lot of guys, a lot of men.
Yeah.
Like, there's no one who's sitting there and they're like, yeah, you're hot, but hey, you like deep.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it always happens to the ladies. And it's like, why must women be deep? Why must you have this other layer to you?
Oh my God.
I think also because men also aren't written as emotional characters, so they don't always need the depth.
True.
Because they don't always have to showcase the
that
depth.
Part, yeah.
Whereas women are emotionally charged. Oh, she's going to cry here. Yeah. She's going to break down in this moment.
Yeah.
So the expectations aren't always as high. But maybe I'm being a little bit unfair and a little bit biased, but I think that might be one of the reasons.
Yeah, it is. But I agree with you, but I would say that that's a problem. Because men, there's nothing wrong with a man showing emotions.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. I believe the real men show their emotions.
Yeah.
True.
Right? So that's why I don't have an issue when a man has an outburst, because society and culture, I don't know about you guys, has trained men to be strong. There is nothing.
And we're seeing the impact of that.
Yes, recently.
Absolutely.
Do you get what I mean?
We should allow men to cry.
Men should,
and we should tell stories where we show that
it affects us. That's why the women are the ones, they're saying, oh, she needs to do more. But do you know, as an actor, what someone is facing when they get on set? That's another aspect. When you go on set, what if you're going through heartbreak?
Sure.
There was a movie I acted. It's called Still Falling. I was supposed to cry because someone died. Oh, I cried from my heart.
Yeah.
I was wailing. I was in the mood because I was going through it.
Sure.
And they said cut. I was still crying after.
Wait, let me tell you, in South Africa, it's called umgowo. So say umgowo.
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 Umgowo. That's what I wasn't going.
So after this short interlude, we are going to see firsthand a little of our guests' acting magic through a fun little game of improv. Are you ladies ready?
No.
Are you ready? And you might even get Zweli up to be a part of the cast. You do not want to miss it, okay? Stick around.
So the government officials took everything.
Car. My place. Locked the cards. I literally have nothing. Except my clothes and this bag, but.
Hey. Come here.
No, please.
Come here.
No, don't feel sorry for me now, please. This is exactly what I get for making dumb decisions, and you know you were right. This is karma.
Karma? Come on. What do you know about karma? Lalela lavu. Mina nawe sibuya kude. So, I'm cheating at karma.
So this isn't the moment where you say, oh, Vuvu, I told you so.
Nope. This is not the part where I go, Vuvu, I told you so. When I was one gamma flop one, So, what are you gonna do now?
So our game today is all about our guests showing just how badass they are when it comes to this thespian thing, right? And if you think that women can only do a few types of roles, well, prepare to have your face ripped off, okay? Because we're about to give you a scene and a half in this game of improv that we're about to play. When I say we, I mean you four, okay? So the rules of the game are very simple. I'm going to give each of you a character, right? And then I'm going to give you a scene. And all you need to do is just complete the scene from where I give it to you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right. But to make it fun and interesting, at any point, I'm going to yell out a genre to change into, right? So whatever line you stopped at, you must repeat that line in that new genre and then carry on the scene.
Oh, wow.
Let me lay out the scene for you. It's very simple. Sharon, you are the supervillain. Right? And you have kidnapped Zweli, who's our damsel in distress. He has no lines, but let me tell you right now, those facial expressions. Distress, okay? Distress. Kate, you are the super spy agent. Oh, you see, we kitted you out already. Super spy agent.
Oh my gosh.
And you are sent to bring Zweli home. Candice, you are Kate's nerd psychic, who's clearly out of their depth. And we've been talking about depth this whole time. But you got to spend a day in the field because there's budget cuts, okay? So you're the sidekick to Kate.
Okay.
All right,
oh
you're trying
gosh.
To save Zweli. Right. Your opening genre is comedy, so it's a funny scene.
Okay.
Okay. Sharon, I'm going to start with you. You're going to start off the scene. And action!
Katie Kate. How did you manage to get past my top of the art security?
My grandmother is a sangoma.
What's that?
What's his name? Sangoma.
Do you know who you're talking to?
Who is? Just.
Candice is in it.
Candice, I'm all the way in.
Okay. She's a nerd, yes.
I got your list be swell.
Let's change to horror. It's a horror movie now. Let's go.
Katie, how did you move past my top security? Mm.
Look behind you.
What is that?
It's a dagger!
I'm done with Candice. This is it.
Candice, I'm dead.
Candice, I quit.
I am dead.
Can I quit?
Let's do romance.
Okay. Ooh. Who's my lover? Mm. Katie? You know that I really do love you, but I'm just worried about how, and I'm not trying to offend you, I'm just worried about how you were able to move past all that security to get here. Mm. I don't know, how are you able to break this? I don't know. I just feel hurt that you were able to move past all that security and come in here.
Baby, I'd move the ocean for you.
Stop.
Mm. Oh, I'm still here. Okay.
Wait.
Stop!
Is this what I think is happening?
How could you?
Swelly, is it you?
Candice, I'm trying to hold myself from crying. Can you please just not do this right now?
Let's do action.
You see this gun?
Yes.
If you move two steps in my Nigerian accent, you go hit your face.
If you open your mouth
if
one
you,
more
if
time.
If you say something one more time.
I am the nerd psychic that can also take this.
And cut.
Done with you.
The psychic is dead.
She's dead.
Terrible.
To wake up no more.
I was a damsel in distress, but I'm like, I'm laughing. So I'm like, I can't be stressed.
I like it, man.
We like it too.
Come on, Kat. Come on. Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. Spirit.
Come on.
Activate.
Oh, that's brilliant.
That is brilliant.
Y'all are crazy.
Oh, man, guys, thank you so much. Thank you. You are absolutely incredible guests. We've loved having you on Never Late African Time.
Oh, yes.
Our lovely guests, Candice Modiselle, Catherine Kamau, and Sharon Ooja. It's been such a wonderful experience, guys, having you on the podcast today. And we hope that you watching and everyone else is richer from this experience. Oh. Send through your thoughts on how you feel about the typecast effect and check out all of the lovely films, series, stories that are told by our lovely friends here on Netflix. It is our time to shine because Africans are never late.
Oh,
no,
yeah.
No. We are never late.
Well, never.
We are always on time.
Come on.
What time, Andy?
African time.
That's it.
Period.
Now streaming on all podcast platforms.